super well. Final pick here.
Okay. So if they can find the matchup, Poppy into Yasuo, and then Gnar can play some other lane based on where he goes.
Poppy,
I think they're
mid?
Assuming
probably
it's Yasuo mid, just to play Yasuo mid, just to play Yasuo Gragas, and just give TheShy the Qiyana, regardless of matchup. This is going to be fun.
So Poppy mid has been a thing in Korean solo queue for a long time.
Yep.
As an answer to certain picks, it does quite a lot of burst damage as well. There's a lot of walls that you can use your heroic charge into. It's usually a very pocket counter pick, but we're into quarters, and look at this craziness!
You've got a very melee-heavy team with a Yuumi to back it up. Griffin have some engage tools. They've got a lot of melee auto-attacks in there. The swaps are done. All right.
Yeah, watching Griffin try and find fights into Gragas, Lulu, Qiyana, all these CCs is going to be fascinating to watch.
And now if you add in the Poppy, she can really dive into the backline with a Yuumi. So they got a lot of different angles they can try to attack, and usually kog'maw wants to see all of his threats in front of him and safely disengage.
Well, a new champion added to the roster, the kog'maw in the bottom lane. Meanwhile, Gnar Poppy solos are in for Griffin. I am already excited for a quarterfinals, gentlemen. This is exciting. Welcome to Summoner's Rift for game one of the quarterfinals. Invictus Gaming are defending their world championship against one of the best teams this tournament has ever seen. Griffin, the number two seed from Korea, played so well to get the top seed here. They drew IG, and most people expect Korea wins this one.
And with that top seed, they chose the red side and have definitely gone down the counterpicking rabbit hole. But, and there is a but here, is that to get the counter picks in the lane matchups they want, they have sacrificed traditional damage. When you think of what a mid to late game team fight looks like, we've got Poppy in the mid lane, Gnar is very unreliable for damage. Honestly, Yuumi might be the highest damage dealer here by a lot, and then no one else really trailing her. So because of that, it feels like early to mid game execution, which was on point from Griffin a few days ago, is what we're gonna have to be really closely inspecting.
I think so, and also when we're looking across counter picks, there's a lot of very interesting stuff happening. So I feel like the general team comp by Griffin counters Qiyana, because there's not a good target for Qiyana to actually find any type of assassination on. Normally, it's get your lethality items, go to hit a squishy target. Those squishy targets actually don't exist. Yuumi's untargetable, and Elise can also dodge things with repel. So there should be no one that Rookie can find assassinations on. But on the flip side, you have a bunch of people with high max health that kog'maw with lethal tempo will be able to shred through throughout the game. So hitting the proper timing windows is going to be very important.
And while this shouldn't be no surprise when kog'maw is in the game, it really is. Does Griffin trivialize kog'maw's teamfight impact at the start of a fight? Or does kog'maw move back from a lot of melee champions and just kite out and do big damage and decide it? Because if kog'maw is not dealt with, then I think IG wins 100% of fights.
No, right now, early push into the bottom lane. We're looking at the mid laners fight over some farm, as Rookie so far doing pretty well on CS. Might have to drop some of the cast minions onto the turret, but so far so good over there. Ning got a pretty heavy leash on the blue buff there, did the full left side clear, making his way down to the bottom jungle, at least doing very similar things from the north jungle.
Looking at the map here already, some vision missions done by Griffin to open things up. Topside start by Elise, not necessarily always standard here, but seems like she's anticipating some bot side shenanigans very shortly.
Yeah, you want to make sure that the Garen Yuumi can't get punished super early on into the game, since, yeah, they are just going to be pushed in early. Be interested to see if Ning tries to do anything mid. It's actually going to be very difficult to gank Chovy. He has no reason to ever use his W preemptively and can just really wait for Gragas to go in, and then if they ever try and get an initiation, he can just proc his aftershock that way and become very tanky. So Chovy should be fairly comfortable pushing up in lane here.
The one small thing I've seen is he has been using it a little bit for damage. I saw under turret, Rookie jumped in, got grounded, so there is some degree of trading going on pretty actively there. And now as the bottom scuttle comes over to Ning, we're not going to have much aggression down here on the bottom side.
Want to also talk about the Elise combos that Griffin have run. Elise Renekton is one they've been running since the start of the tournament. I think there's a lot of Elise Renekton in this Elise Poppy duo that we're going to see in the mid lane, very much for the stun hits. If you stand next to a wall, if Elise hits a cocoon, the follow-up is insane, and Poppy does have a lot of base burst damage if she's landing her full rotation, so I think they're trying to ape that and potentially roam with it too.
All right, Ward spots out the first gank of the quarterfinals. TheShy running away. Has to respect Tarzan, but if Windwall's up, you're not going to cocoon that, so simply walks backwards. Should have seen the mid laner come in as well, so they're aware of that timing. And could go back into the lane as he, I believe, Chovy was recalling on the ward.
Yeah, and there's going to be a question of where does Tarzan actually put his time early game, because he doesn't have anything up on the map reasonably right now to do. His Krugs will be up shortly, so until then, he's actually just going to kind of hang out up here, and it's interesting how he actually misses the sweep, even though it was fairly obvious they walked over a ward.
We're throwing up some stats here from that four games that Griffin played last week on the second round robin. The kill-death ratio on the right side is so impressive, a 7.3 kills for every death incurred. I went and looked at stats, and I actually asked, has there ever been a better day of best of one play than what we saw from Griffin earlier this tournament? And the answer was actually no. It was probably the most impressive statistical and eye test day of games we've seen from one team.
Yeah, and you can even see their group stage kill death. This is Worlds all time. Griffin would be ranked third. If you notice, the two teams above them did end up winning a world championship. So kill-death ratio is by no means the be-all, end-all of who will win Worlds, but Griffin's group stage in context was very impressive.
Now TP back at the top side. Tarzan has continued to stay up here as the Raptor camp has come back up, hoping to find something on TheShy, who's been playing fairly aggressively, built a very large CS lead on the Yasuo. That's the counterpick we're looking for. There's still no gank to be had, and as the camps come up, the Elise has to get the farm on.
A lot of containment done by Griffin so far, but the game really does pivot when Boots of Mobility are done. There was no snowball kill into Boots of Mobility rush from Rookie, but we know that's very likely on the way. If they can keep river control on both sides here, then we won't see a return to form of Rookie, who was really dominating the side lanes against TL so effortlessly on Qiyana.
And I also have to say that the bottom lane of Garen Yuumi isn't necessarily expected to win early. They're expected to then turn on kind of once Yuumi gets towards Luden. So this early game is going to be about Griffin stopping the bleeding as much as possible, and they're not necessarily doing that very well in the top lane, and it'll be very fun to track how powerful JackeyLove gets in what is essentially a fairly easy lane for him.
Important ward down there, spotting Ning once again. Chovy using Steadfast Presence to continue the trades with Rookie. Grounds him, turns on Aftershock, makes that all happen. But a couple times we've come to this lane and seeing those abilities used in the one-on-one. That means you can't stop the body slam flash anymore, so it's certainly an important cooldown to track. And as Ning gets closer to six, and he's been farming well, right? He's already got more than 10 camps done. Ning with that ultimate can certainly try to force a kill.
Seeing the trades continue here. Infernal first spawn, but the double control ward bot side does stop any early Infernal start from Griffin. They are a team that, while being very tanky, probably do scale pretty decently with Infernal Drake. And obviously, as a team that has a pretty low damage profile later, you want any sort of snowball you can get. But right now, so far, the setup not there.
And if we think about the overall pace of this game, even though there's a 500 gold lead for IG, I would say this is much more of a Griffin-style game than an IG-style game. In terms of deaths, every split Griffin has played in the LCK, they've had the fewest deaths in the LCK. They are a low-error League of Legends team. Invictus Gaming, despite making it to Worlds, had the most deaths in the LPL summer split. They are a very high-error team that is willing to take risks and oftentimes will outplay you through more good plays that overpower the bad. So Papasmithy and I had this conversation earlier this week. What would, like, the combined kills per minute breakpoint need to be for IG to win versus for Griffin to win? And we think it ends up having to be very high just because of the way Griffin is used to playing. So this is very much a Griffin-paced game, which, despite the goal lead, at least early on, makes you think they're in a decent position.
Well, there's a fun extra wrinkle to that in that IG, we've already noted, as Tarzan doesn't hit the cocoon on screen there, is that we do feel like IG's multiple damage dealers maybe does give them something resembling a kind of scaling advantage as the game goes on. It's not as one-to-one as that, but we already saw Griffin be played against their tendencies with G2 scaling draft on the first day of Worlds, going for the Ornn and going for a lot of late-game scaling. In this sort of a game, we can't just give the pass mark based on historic performance with kind of low kill games. We do have to look at IG and say, okay, you pack a lot of punch.
And I think the kog'maw is the big thing that kind of throws a wrench into all of these projections. If he is able to stick strong in team fights as all these melee champions just kind of run at him, it's going to be probably what decides the game, is how well can Griffin find access to JackeyLove. Because from what I've seen, Garen Yuumi scales incredibly well, but it also hasn't played into a kog'maw before.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a very big thing. What we're seeing also is the third play of the game going over to Invictus. We've already seen the bot lane take two. You're seeing a 27 CS lead for the kog'maw. TheShy, by the way, didn't burn his TP when he went back to lane a while ago after his first recall. So the tools are here for IG to force a big fight, maybe around this early Infernal. That gives you some of that extra scaling advantage, by the way, if you really want it. But as we see, the TP is finally used. They finally cash that in as he goes into the top lane. And now Chovy is here on a roam.
Watching the player come together here. Tarzan lying in wait. These are the sort of areas where Tarzan was able to outpath against G2 in those couple of victories in a row. The Chovy quickly returns to mid lane. Topside advantage is a little bit bigger than I anticipated pre-one item. I feel like after the base stats nerfs years ago, Yasuo doesn't crush Gnar in the 1v1 like he once did, but it does scale to be a very strong matchup. Should only get better as it goes on.
And I think a lot of that is just, oh yeah, it's the shy. He's
Sword.
Gonna be able to have large CS advantage against basically everyone that he plays against. On the flip side, with the full upgrade on Viper's support item, the gold generation is actually going to start catching up in aggregate.
With some mobility actually matched by Chovy, so it seems like he wants to be the same sort of roaming threat that Qiyana can threaten. To be CC-wise, definitely able to ape what Qiyana does with the burst damage. Not usually there as the game continues to roll on. Right now, honestly, a bit of a Galio type here, just really trying to keep Rookie accountable for CS and roams where possible.
All right, well, again, looking at the attempted trades down there. Jumps away, Rookie doesn't want to take that trade anymore. Chovy seems to be kind of putting his presence on the lane at this point. Rookie had a very early CS lead. That's turned back around. TheShy, rushing Static Shiv, has even more lane pressure, freeing him up to make more of these moves around the map. Spotted all by a control. We're not going to find a fight onto Chovy, but they can push in the mid lane.
And I want to take a moment to appreciate how high these CS numbers are. We're 11 minutes in, and all three IG carries are at 10 CS per minute, and then Chovy is actually above it as mid lane Poppy. So Sword and Viper, I feel, are actually closer to average lane CS, and everyone else in the game is actually exceeding it.
We sound like boomers a bit there, because 85 at 11 minutes is a little bit behind, but I tend to agree with you, right?
Especially in a lot of IG games where you do see higher action, you see more CS denial coming through. These are very high numbers.
We'll see if those numbers are abated for a moment. Rookie and IG seem aware about the Infernal being started by Griffin.
And even though it's in Fog of War, IG looking around, but Rookie's at half HP, and they don't really have sight onto how low it's getting. It's getting too low, and they finally find some room in the bottom lane, instantly turn it around. Infernal Drake picked up, ejected IG players, and Griffin get the first objective of the game.
And even thinking about how the group stage went, oftentimes IG was a collection of individuals who overall won the game through their individual achievements. And we kind of see that with the Infernal Drake. You have the lane pressure the whole early game, and you can't get the Infernal Drake. And finally, they're going bot.
And the flash to chase through. He's rooted in place, so has plenty of damage output there, but he's running down, and first blood comes through to Viper's Garen. And now the pile driver to the bottom lane. Baolan's getting low. The polymorph not going to do anything. It's 2-0 in the bottom lane. The wave clear comes through, and Griffin strikes first.
A very exquisite reflection of that team versus individual identity. The moment that Viper went in, you saw there was perfect synergy with Sword coming down as well. TheShy teleported. We saw him teleport to top earlier.
Yeah.
So he had no ability to match. They're just using a very standard advantage. TP advantage top leads to two kills for the side of Griffin.
And at least in that engagement, it looked almost trivial for Viper to be able to get access to the kog'maw with the Yuumi. Not a very mobile AD carry. And if the Lulu wall shield doesn't allow him to actually just outduel the Garen, he's going to lose that one.
And it's the difference in lane states when it's a 2v2 normal laning phase and five people A-ramming in mid. So obviously in that case, kog'maw can be really far back, looking to trade, looking to CS. Moment that you have that cleanse of CC available on that slow cleanse on Garen, engage comes in, nicely done by Griffin.
Yeah, I want to point out actually a very poor ultimate by Ning there. Probably had the ability to knock Chovy into turret and secure at least one kill back, but IG will remain killless as we see the lane swap come through already from Griffin.
It still feels like a 2-on-2 that I like from Invictus Gaming. The Blade of the Rune King for JackeyLove was up and ready when that last fight happened, still couldn't kite away. Still, of course, has that item moving in towards the boots upgrades and might still try to farm some plates. I want to point out that even despite those kills picked up by Griffin, more than 1,000 gold there, the gold is still equal slash IG favored from 30 to 50 CS from lanes and the plates taken earlier.
So you start asking the question, okay, if this is a Griffin victory from this point, what does it look like? Because again, I feel like if we're grouping as five and staring each other down, not getting to the kog'maw going to be really tricky, and that will absolutely favor Ning. It's going in.
They're going to find the cast backwards, but Garen is very, very tanky, slows down, doesn't seem to matter, though. Roots up the squad, still walking backwards, he just refuses to die. Garen, invincible in a 2v4.
And he only gets tankier from the rest of the game. He's going to be able to sustain up a lot as they're now trying to bring a fight back with Gragas and Qiyana ultimate down.
And we get the confirmation that also trying to pick Garen. Not going to be a way the game moves forward. The way I think Griffin closes this is getting control vision as Baolan already falls low and forcing face checks. That's where Poppy, Elise, Yuumi can get picks across the map.
Fight down here. Down. Yeah, still battling across this map is TheShy putting some damage towards Chovy, but right, stacking armor is Poppy with both those soul lanes doing that kind of damage is not doing a whole lot.
And TheShy is the other hyperscaler that IG can try and use to win this game. While IG has been trying to make all these plays, TheShy is just filling himself with minion gold and is kind of, I feel like, trying to rush towards an Infinity Edge, so he would also be someone who can slice through.
And honestly, you'll probably feel like the strongest champion in mid-game fights is going to be Chovy. It's against three AD damage dealers, and stacking armor on Poppy always super high in terms of ability. But the Rift Herald down to 4,000 health here.
Ult's still down on IG, so it's hard for them to force a good fight.
It's going to be good damage to the Viper. They're going to have to jump back into the pit, but now without the silence, it's going to make it much more difficult. TheShy walks up, puts down the wind wall, takes the ignite, gets ulted, and looking for the engage. Good smite, good claim by Tarzan. Is there still to be a fight to be had?
No,
the polymorph in, big damage. Trying to book down Mega Gnar, but he can still flash in. And a nice Zonius buys some space. Tarzan drops down. Sword should lose his life as well, as they're not killing the kog'maw. It's a complete wipe. Poor Lehends has nowhere to go, and that's one life down, an ace for IG.
And IG just destroy Griffin in that fight. Griffin take so long to kill the Rift Herald. They just let the kog'maw and the Yasuo warm up, and the triple kill for kog'maw is the perfect thing as IG break this game open.
Exactly. It feels like we saw the game-breaking moment. Griffin had so many things in their mind. Clearly wanted to pick up the Rift Herald, but they weren't respecting the chance for a collapse to actually be successful. And when Sword's Mega Gnar bar actually doesn't end up being the thing that zones away the enemy, they've taken too much incidental damage before the engage can happen.
By the time the fight starts, Chovy's at 15% health. So Griffin actually needed to bail as much as they could, but they had no way out other than trying to fight through. Really just actually IG's patience that ends up paying dividends in this fight.
I feel like Sword's ult was also pretty crap right there. Aims pretty much straight up, pushes the kog'maw to relative safety. Again, this team is basically all melee. Only the Gnar could follow through. Garen had to peel back and fight TheShy instead. And so 2,500 damage, highest in the fight, goes to the Kog. That was scooped to safety.
And it only gets better for IG. Infernal Drake is up. Sword is top lane without teleport. It feels like that one fight has kind of broken Griffin's map play, at least temporarily. They've decided they're unwilling to 5v5, which is probably the right call based on the power spikes IG just hit.
But that plays into some of our analysis about how Griffin's comp plays. From ahead, controlling space, having to come to them, absolute terror for IG to deal with. But when they don't control maps, when they're often going to be behind in terms of vision control, they're a fiercely melee team with low damage at best.
Well, they're going to try to find their comeback somewhere, but already the game seems like it's flipped. A 3,000 gold lead in the Infernal's Tide. As another turret falls, it's closer and closer to 4,000. As IG can already look at the fact that they've got two completed items of the kog'maw. This is this is Kog Online. This is Blade of the Rune King Rageblade. He's going to destroy everything.
Look at the scale here. It's about 3,800 gold. All in that play around the five kills, and so much of it going on to the kog'maw.
It almost feels like IG should should just win the game from this point on, is what you would think. And it would be on Griffin to need to split them up, find exactly the right team fights, and get picks. Otherwise, IG has the gold in the right places.
Honestly, it feels like Griffin have to get Baron control and find a way to kill it, even though they have very low Baron speed here. Yeah. That's the objective that brings you back into a game. And that's a two-part plan, where before, they kind of controlled wherever they roamed to first. Now we've already seen them seed an Infernal Drake, and some of the queries about whether they can make an objective play happen. It'll, at minimum, take a long time, and we already saw that can be turned around by IG.
Well, we've mentioned power spikes a few times. I want to point out a very smart item out of Viper here with the adaptive helm coming through. JackeyLove is nothing but, okay, not nothing but largely on-hit magic damage, repeated magic damage, which he will deny quite a lot of, so at least that's valuable here. And if you can still catch that backlane, if you get a really good flash cocoon, there's not a good way out. JackeyLove's got flash not cleanse. There's no QSS. There's no Mikhail's on his squad right now. Maybe that comes in at some point soon as Baolan adds a couple of fairy charms to maybe push towards that.
Yeah, Baolan should be building a Mikhail's next. Otherwise, I'll be very disappointed in the item choices based on kind of the ways that Griffin can win this game. It's all about if they can catch out JackeyLove in a fight.
We're probably not at the tipping point yet where damage items outweigh kind of the early tankiness that Griffin have been able to pick up and how their champions interact with the stats they picked up. So there still is that perfect setup from Griffin, but like we've alluded to multiple times, it needs to be dealing with JackeyLove, forcing him to flash out or just put out no DPS in a fight. Right now, it's just standard laning phases of the game, as we see everyone returning here. The Baron about to respawn, though, or at least spawn for the first time, and that will be the focal point of this game.
And towards the top they go. Can they find Sword? The answer is no. They're going to turn back around and let that one just go back towards his tier 2 turret. But Baron is spawned on the map. The range advantage clearly does go to Invictus Gaming. And actually, they found the engage anyway. It was just Rookie who snuck up, finds his thumb, and now an engage in the top river. And they will shut down the kog'maw. They take down the jungler as well. And Griffin find the 2-for-1 fight.
And that could have been a very good play for IG, but when you send both your solo laners up to top lane, you should not be contesting river with the rest of your team. So Griffin are able to find the comeback and actually win out on that trade.
That exposed underbelly being taken advantage of is exactly why people were skeptical of IG picking up the win here. They do make those fundamental errors where they lose out to a TP advantage on the top lane, or they allow themselves to be collapsed when they're just straight up getting a 1-for-0 in the top side. We're going to see the full replay. This is the top side play where Rookie did not have to walk through vision for the first time this game. And the burst is pretty insane, let's be real. But it's this other side where Viper's flash is enough to close the distance on the kog'maw.
Yeah, Cocoon landed at the start by Tarzan, and that makes the close fairly easy. Griffin will need more fights almost exactly like that if they want to look to come back in this game.
All right, so next up, Baolan picks up Forbidden Idol, adds some more shielding power there, and we'll continue to wait to see what finally that comes through into. 3,000 gold difference still in Invictus Gaming, the ones who are richer here, but you are seeing what these picks can look like.
Yeah, and speaking of money, look at the Shy CS right now.
Yeah.
240 to 21.
My eyes went to the same place.
Yeah, the top lane average for CS at 20 for top laners this tournament was 166. The Shy was at least 50 over the tournament average in this game, and he's not slowing down anytime soon.
It's a matchup that only gets better with levels for the Yasuo, and he's close to flame horizoning at 22 minutes. So that lets you know the side lane around the TP Gnar is not going to be a win condition for Griffin. How they can actually stop that just being another reason that IG have mid-game supremacy. Roams like this would go a long way. Chovy's flash is up.
They might just go for him.
At a potential slow towards JackeyLove, is the team going to go forward? Viper burns the Q, W's to go backwards. You can see, though, that health bar gets burned down, and now it might be time for Ning to walk in. Pulls Predator, decides to only kill a ward now instead. Yeah. Looking again at the poke, they're going to find a little bit. Baolan does take pretty good damage there. Keep in mind, that is a pretty scary Lulu who is now finally building towards Lutens.
And Griffin is kind of on the wrong side of the map right here. The 22-minute Ocean Drake isn't that valuable. I would say Baron control would be much more important. Not to mention the Shy is still getting bottom lane pressure. So while Griffin looked for that play, they actually lost a decent amount of wave tempo as they now try and move to get Baron control.
And a very small thing that came from the 5 kills earlier, we were focused on how much gold kog'maw picked up, is that all 5 stacks of Ingenious Hunter went to Gragas, and he's actually just using Predator just to pull people out of the fog, work out where Poppy is, because you have to respond to the Predator pot coming out. So it's actually getting a lot of value there, that CDR on the Predator. It's actually off cooldown again already.
TheShy grabs the Ocean Drake. Not the most meaningful this later on in the game, but it does have some use when you're considering that Yuumi poke is one of the primary tools that Griffin has to get around the map. Once the fight starts, of course, that turns off. TheShy's got to run away. He's in a 1v3. Gets the Q out, not the wind wall. That's going to be rough to try to get away. Doesn't have a good way out. Gets shut down, and Griffin get a kill to get a bit of map control.
Important second point that they knew that kog'maw was on a reset, so there was no Baron potential, sending three members to kill the Yasuo. Big amount of shutdown, experience, and also map reset now granted to Griffin.
And that's the other side of TheShy. You don't get 270 CS at 22 minutes without being a little bit greedy and taking some rather large risks. So at that point, yes, the team was on a reset. Yes, he should have gone back. That's the correct League of Legends play. But he wanted to greed for the blue buff, and he gets caught out for it. And it costs IG a lot. He loses the wave pressure. More gold goes on the sword. He's able to get solo turret gold. He's more likely to be able to match Gnar. And the actual game is now within 1.5K.
Yeah, overall about 1,000 gold went back to Griffin off of that.
See what they can do in terms of map setup here, because already some spotting control wards around the red side jungle, and for once, Gnar being able to push the minions into in a bot lane turret. Usually that, again, means that you can start making Baron plays, but we talk about this often. There's very little Baron threat coming from the side of Griffin, so as IG, you can take those extra half seconds to talk to your team and really get the comms straight, because you don't respect a rush of Baron by Griffin, really, at all.
Might not be a rush of Baron. Jatt, I know we talked about the kill screws coming in. It's going to be the redemption, though, through for Baolan. Instead, JackeyLove stops to pick up QSS, then pushes forward on damage items. I agree with you, Jatt. I would like the greedier kog'maw build, rely on the Lulu for that, but it's just the way they played it.
The whole game, I feel like, could potentially pivot on whether or not
Jackie
can
right now.
Outduel.
They look for the root, pops QSS, runs backwards, but he's still silenced. Flashes the wave of swords right on top of him, and again, JackeyLove goes down. He is unable to fight, and it's time for Griffin to push through. They've knocked back Rookie. Looks like they're going to disengage, just take the single kill. That's three in a row. The Griffin find a single kill and walk back.
And that's what they can do when they have summoners up and they're able to gap close in multiple different ways. We laid it out clearly. JackeyLove goes down. IG definitely have to reset and wait for him. How much can Griffin
threaten? Gnarl's up. They find the stun. They're going to knock down Rookie. Had to face check the brush. And Griffin continue to find more kills. Chovy finds almost a stun in TheShy as well. Sword wants in for the slow. Will be a disengage finally.
And their team play has been so good. They still have flash on Garen for the next time JackeyLove comes up. So I think they're going to try and repeat these pick plays around Baron. Remember, their Baron is very slow. So it's going to be difficult for them to actually take it. Therefore, they're going to try and get picks off of vision plays.
Everything for Griffin after the five deaths around Rift Herald is difficult, and yet they're executing. Their decisions and how decisive they are is what is keeping them here, because otherwise, TheShy slamming sword and 5v5s are looking tricky getting towards a kog'maw who has a lot of mobility provided by the Lulu, and yet, so far, they're staying in this game, and IG's fundamental small mistakes that we've seen in groups, that we saw in the LPL, are holding them back from actually shutting the door on Griffin.
Little column A, little column B, some mistakes made by IG, and perhaps the Griffins were finding the openings. Cannot quite knock back Viper, walked up for the ward, turned around in time.
Thornmail actually is the first armor item done, and again, makes a lot of sense. Half a kog'maw damage, and Qiyana and Yasuo needs no explanation there. So they've got a face checker for sure. Your control wards don't last long against Griffin, because eventually Garen walks up and deletes them. Speaking of deletion, we get the replay.
Yeah, and this was a small 20% slow onto JackeyLove into just a Yuumi all in. So yes, they root, they silence, you can QSS flash, but you're just going into yet another engager. The key there was actually sword flanking around the side and being able to find access.
And then when it comes to this dark map, how long can you wait? Rookie did leave. This is about 15 seconds, right? So they could be on Baron here. Unfortunately, they're not when it comes to Rookie's perspective, and he goes down.
Yeah, and there was a very small window to pull that off because Rookie was about to go invisible. That's why he jumped in to grab the grass blade and was planning on queuing immediately. So if the immediate stun didn't come through from Griffin, there's a chance that Rookie actually gets away from that.
Yeah, but still spotted out, taken down. And we can again look at the map state, a 900 gold difference. IG still in a small lead. Still also up that one Ocean Drake, but a tight game here. Zeal done for the kog'maw. I am perennially on kog'maw watch. A Last Whisper in for Rookie. A Steric's Gauge plus the Infinity Edge done for TheShy. So I do want to point out that it's not always just kog'maw, right? The other champions matter a lot as well of the IG carries. They do have plenty of damage output there. The question is, can they withstand all the picks that Griffin are putting out?
Yeah, how long does it take for Griffin to kill Kog? And how much time does that buy TheShy to really do a bunch of damage in the fight, because there are two hyper carries that IG have in their roster.
But when we do see the usual setups of five champions in mid, the only person you can Gragas cast is the Yasuo, right? As backline.
Oh, they caught Rookie.
Found a catch, Rookie! Over the wall, onto a ward, just goes down right away, and it means that's Inferno Control yet again to Griffin. IG just needed a team fight, and Rookie hands it away.
Yeah, Rookie's setups against TL really got them into the quarterfinals, but his setup there was well caught by the side of Griffins. To my point, though, they need to find a way to actually use their Gragas Yasuo to threaten, because so far, Gragas doesn't want to ult Yasuo. Sorry, Gragas doesn't want to ult Garen, because he's the only person he gets access to. And then kog'maw is killed. It's really about Ning finding a 3-4 man cast in a fight and getting the most out of the Shy, as the gold lead is definitely coming down.
Look at that comeback from Griffin. After they're a bunch of melee champions into a kog'maw, they have not allowed IG any favorable fight. They gave them the most favorable fight at Rift Herald, but being able to bounce back from that makes this a very competitive game.
It's best of five, starting out strong can really help you kind of start forcing the pick and ban around, say, ah, you know, we can't beat Garen, or we can beat Garen. You can start making things really awkward there as the blue goes over to Rookie pretty easily.
And this Garen Yuumi strategy isn't something that will make or break the series, but I can understand why Griffin wanted to throw it out in game one, because you gain such a pick ban advantage if you're actually able to come back in a game like this where, okay, IG had the counter. They proved it doesn't work. It would just limit their ability to ban for the rest of the series.
And while pick ban advantage is one thing, think of the mental edge they get when you know that IG were probably prematurely feeling super confident after getting their 5 kills and coming back here. So edging out this game, coming from behind when so much in the side lane, and honestly the 5v5 scene set up for IG, has to be both a mental and drafting advantage to Griffin.
Well, item still coming through. Pretty close to Dead Man's Plate now on the Viper. Just needs the combine for that one. The second adaptive helm through onto the Poppy as well. The components right now on top of Sword. So it's a good mix of armor and magic. This one, all the squad. And that is kind of the damage types here of IG. Kog tends to be about 50-50. And obviously, Qiyana and Yasuo, very physical heavy. Gragas, you notice he did not go for the flat pin build. I think that's very, very smart. He's not going towards the Oblivion Orb because he knows his targets are all tanked with high magic resist. So often we see players buy the wrong items. This one, I want to give a high five to Ning for not doing a flat pin build in this game.
Completely agree with you. It's about IG finding the right type of target access. It's difficult because it is a bunch of tanks that they're going to have to be fighting against. So a lot of it is just extending the fight, properly kiting back. Or can they actually just burst down this bear? And they have a lot of damage.
Looking at the setup now, trying to rush this one down. Viper coming around the wings. JackeyLove shields off the first
Rookie.
One. And there's Rookie looking for a big stun. Yasuo on top! And they're going to have Zorb pop the zone. They've knocked down one, but it's only the Gragas. That's a big ult from Sword. Is the re-engage enough? Rookie's off in the wings, but kog'maw refuses to die. He's on four. Looks for Chovy. It's stolen away. Rookie denies the Penta. But Baron, you have to believe, goes to Invictus Gaming.
And starting off that Baron allowed them to finally get the start they were looking for. Rookie not caught out this time. His start actually ended with aplomb by JackeyLove.
And that fight was just decision overload for Griffin. Look at the Baron. We have to stop the Baron. Wait! Here's Rookie. And even though the start of the fight seemed like Griffin was able to turn it around early, the fact that they used so much of their burst on a Qiyana who had already used the cooldowns meant they had nothing left for the decisive kill they needed on kog'maw. So yes, Yuumi repels the first engage. Windwall stops Tarzan. They burst the Qiyana, and now Jackie gets to fire. The damage, it stopped. They don't have enough damage left. And you can see, even though he gets very low, that's all the time it takes for the kog'maw to clean.
And the magic trick of the IG comp is create enough ruckus for JackeyLove to kill everyone on Hurricane Rageblade.
Kog'maw, speaking of, the picks might get to start. The ult into the Yasuo. Of course, again, those are tanky champions. Don't quite get to go down. But you're seeing now IG ready for the push. Ult comes in. They're going to find JackeyLove.
Oh, no.
He's going to drop yet again. Griffin, just jump right in. Look at the ulti in from Sword. And they are spinning to win all over the top of IG. A couple of kills come back. The Shy tries to run. Don't know if he can take this one. He cannot. But Rookie's here. And Baolan's right behind him. It's overall 3 deaths on IG. Only 2 down on Griffin.
And IG is teamwork away from being unbeatable because their individual mechanics are so good, but then they face check four people down mid lane while Rookie is prepping a side wave and get immediately engaged on.
And that's the amazing thing, is it's what we built up. It really does feel like the unstoppable force versus the immovable object, because at the end of the day, for all IG do right and the game-breaking moves they make, they keep not having the fundamentals to close it out in a timely fashion.
Here comes a flank from Rookie.
TP and coming TP. In as well.
It's a Yasuo.
Going for the big play. They're going to find that stun. But do they have the damage to kill a Garen? With kog'maw, they probably do. But
uh-oh.
Here come the
kog'maw.
Suddenly they are on top of him. And yet again, JackeyLove doing so much true damage in this game, but not enough to kill the champion.
I completely missed it. Yasuo is dead. It was a kog'maw flank. You can't do that in a situation like this.
The flanking kog'maw is not the deadliest.
That's a new one.
That is definitely not what you're looking for here. And JackeyLove has been known to make those mistakes on occasion. Not recently. A wonderful year for him. But now, suddenly, IG have a lot of it to do all over again, even though they've broken open this game twice in clear fashion.
We take a bit of a breather here. We've got a minute left on Baron, but it feels like IG's not going to get to use that very much, waiting for JackeyLove to respawn. Big fight in the mid lane, doesn't turn into a kill right away, but the re-engage is so good from Griffin.
Yeah, the big thing you have to note is that Qiyana was just bottom lane clearing out a wave, so Griffin know he's not that close. And they say, okay, JackeyLove, you stepped up. We know you have no flash. We're just going to kill you. And they do that. And then even after that happens, look at how much damage the Shy is able to pump out. Stopwatching at about 200 health. He actually nearly kills Lehends as well after that fight is over, but eventually they chase him down.
It's all about the timing there, and we saw this play, and we knew that Yasuo had perished, so we assumed it's going to be Yasuo in the backline. No, it's a kog'maw who thinks that he has a flank angle. Nope. Oh. Final chapter's back up. They're able to deal with him, and suddenly, somehow, we're basically all even again at 35 minutes.
And you feel like the scaling has to be in the favor of IG. If JackeyLove can just sit and fire, he's a late enough game kog'maw that he'll be able to shred, but we just don't know if that situation is going to arise. He's still flashless. His scimitar is up, which will give him some mobility. Baolan does have his wild growth at this point, so it's a lot of extra health they can pump into him, but we just don't know what's going to happen next.
Red Buff, I think, is actually a really huge deal here with the Hurricane. Love Hurricane against melee heavy compositions. JackeyLove going to try for something as they find the slows back and forth. Viper pushed a bit back. Sword charging up, though. Mega'Gnar is imminent here. That is a cooldown, a state that IG must respect. We can see we're 2 minutes away from Baron respawning here, and I wouldn't be surprised if IG just stayed on this screen for the next 100 seconds or so.
If they can keep eyes on all of Griffin and avoid a flank, then Jackie will be very happy. Because if he can actually flash backwards to continue DPS, with that flash not taking him into yet another threat, that's how IG wins.
So we have to say, viewers, where is that likely to happen? The Baron is where it happened, the last time where they could actually make it about what they wanted rather than respecting every flank angle that Griffin was coming on. Baron himself spawns in a minute 15. I imagine that is IG's conventional way to find a game-breaking lead.
And we had a lot of discussions before the series about how this could range from a 3-0 smash for Griffin to a 3-0 smash for IG, depending on which version of these teams showed up. What I'm really happy about is it feels like this is the best scenario where the evenly matched versions of these teams are facing each other. The strengths are apparent. The weaknesses are as well, and they're just battling it out.
And you just want to see them roll through different pick ban strategies. Put Viper on a conventional AD carry and see how that will carry forward, because if the play level stays the same, we're in for a banger of a series.
Once again, we go to the mid lane wave clear, 30 seconds away from Baron spawning as they push on forward. It's Griffin first to shove this one in. The resets have already come through for IG. No more time to shop. You have to play around this top river right now.
And that control where they just got killed by Griffin is the brush they actually need to control. But if you look at their inventories, they only have enough space for one control ward, so it's actually very difficult for them to be able to stop those flank angles.
And as you mentioned that, IG walk right back in and reclaim all that territory. Yuumi Q used for some wave clear. Once again, Griffin can push in mid, but they have to walk through again all over IG's wards.
And our issue now that we're late enough in the game, is how does Griffin actually break the game open themselves rather than responding to an IG mistake? That is trickier for them as their damage profile gets lower and lower. They want to be able to contest and close the distance, but JackeyLove unlikely to just give over his life in the front line once more.
Poke continuing, wave clear continuing. They know from the dead scuttle crab that IG are probably safe at this Baron. Griffin are not trying it. Their over the wall Baron takes pretty rough. Overall, you could probably blast cone in, but that's it. As Rookie runs around the bottom side of the map, hiding inside this Drake pit, we know that's spawning in 40 seconds. He's looking for maybe a flank play. As Griffin, they can be seen taking down some of the wards. Now the Southern River, some of it belongs to Griffin as well.
But Griffin is getting starved out of wards. Even though they have two Sight Stones, they've used all of their ward charges on both of those Sight Stones and only have one sweeper left. So they say, we can't play this vision game any longer. Let's go for something. Griffin are actually the ones that start the play.
Right as Scuttle despawns, forward they go. Rookie wants to scout, can't see it just yet. They see, okay, that's like three Griffin members. That's not enough to stop the Baron. We're safe yet again. Kog'maw, rank three ultimate, has massive, massive range. JackeyLove can spot check that constantly. Baolan chunked down, but as long as he stays far enough back, that's going to be okay as well. Continued poke, but it's all in a fog of war. The control ward's not bad for IG. Sword by himself, can't go to Mega, looking for the engage. They're layering the CC, and Sword this time is caught out. A blunted object as Redemption puts health bars up, and IG dare a 4v5 teamfight. Damage onto the Baron, waiting to burn that one down. Looking for the re-engage. Two crucial ults are down. Windwall comes down. At what point does the re-engage happen? Rookie only has so many tools, and health bars are low. The Baron is smitten. And IG get to walk away with a kill and the Baron.
And that is such a long death timer. Griffin is scrambling to try and find the right decision. They move straight to Elder because they know IG has a reset, but they are fast coming out. And remember, Griffin can't kill objectives quickly, so it's still 4v5. Griffin is trying for some miracle.
They're looking for a gank rush here. They know they can't just rush down JackeyLove.
They might get Jackie.
He's in the front, the stun only hits one, he flashes back for the safety. This could still be a team for the IG wins, despite the first two kills. Here comes Rookie, here comes the Windwall, all on top, and Viper has to flash to get away, same for Tarzan. They might stay alive, but the Shy is right over the wall and gets the shutdown all the same. It's still a 3v4 for living members as Gnar just respawns. There's a fight now between Chovy and Rookie. The armor is quite high, the armor pen's still the same. Still outnumbered, but the damage comes through, flashes away from the boomerang, and Jackie look at absolutely kill Sword here. The Shy pretty much immune to dragon damage as Griffin kite away. The three on three, though, the carries are the ones alive. IG should rest control, but they are afraid of what the re-engage might look like. They're actually going to disengage here, drop the wards, and let the Shy get away.
They don't have their jungler. Here. Tarzan is the only one with smite.
Poke's coming through.
He doesn't even try.
They're not going to. Dragon comes over, and here's the re-engage. They find the stun, and Sword will die as soon as he respawns. Blue buff handed over. IG have such a lead now.
Death timers are so long that walking up and getting the Elder and dying for 50 seconds is not something Tarzan calculates as the right move. I actually really like this approach where they try to get a pick rather than slowly rush down the Elder. But JackeyLove having flash up and then Hurricane autos means the Shy and Rookie can fight back on the back end.
That backward sidestep by JackeyLove, so the cocoon gets graciously tanked by his jungler Ning, is absolutely worth, because the fact that IG end up having their three carries up and there's no longer a Garen for the ideal Yuumi delivery system means IG can win in the ensuing chaos.
And you just feel like the paranoia must be there for the Griffin fans if they lose with this again. Different approach to the game, lower damage, does echo some of the Pantheon Taliyah games they lost to SKT in the spring final. They've got plenty of games to reset, it's a full best of five, but IG knocking on the Nexus soon.
Chovy's ult unable to disengage them, so that's going to be middle inhibitor turret gone. The inhibit itself now under fire. 6,000 gold lead, still a minute left on both Baron and the Elder Dragon buffs. It's going to be very hard to fight this squad.
I don't think Griffin should go for a fight here, because IG is just going to try and clean inhibitors. There's a good chance this goes to either the next Baron or the next Elder, but it is an even more secure lead for IG.
Recall comes through for Rookie, seemingly that they don't want to fight for the inhibitor itself, just clear away his last few waves. Now, JackeyLove has no more items to buy. Every slot is full, and there's not a lot I would replace there. So giving him the farm is a little awkward, because Ning has an item and a half to go.
Honestly, in the late game, very often damage outstrips tankiness when you try to match it with purchases, when your goal just can't withstand the sort of damage that can be purchased. So with all these tank items, Viper and the rest of Griffin are still very mortal, and JackeyLove is so strong.
If Rookie could find some type of flank, IG would go for the win. What they're probably hoping for is the second inhibitor, because Griffin will have such poor wave clear against two waves of supers, IG would potentially never wrest control of the game back.
Baron buff already gone. Elder Dragon out in 3 seconds.
Down, maybe they go.
The region. There's the dive into the front lines. He wasn't cast, buys a bit of space. They look for the re-engage. A stun towards Sword. He's very, very low. The Shy staying alive. Here comes the re-engage. Magadar puts them all against the wall. But JackeyLove, that's what you got to care about here. Sword barely staying alive. And JackeyLove on the other side of the fight. They should be able to chase down this Gnar. One more open. He's going to run away. Instead, it's the rest of the squad trying to run out. And it's a double kill in for Rookie. Only one dead for IG.
IG's just going to push towards the base. There's only two people left for Griffin. I think they win.
Minions on the Nexus turrets now as well. Battle entrance buys some space with Tarzan there, as that's going to be the turrets falling down. There's only two surviving members. They cannot stop this push anymore. Tarzan does his best, but he is a squirrel and he's going to die. And that's the cat gone as well. The wildlife is gone. It's Invictus Gaming and a slobber knocker taking down game one.
What a fascinating game between Griffin and IG. We tried to build it up. What would it look like? Which IG, which Griffin? We see the best and worst of all of them. And yet, we're probably still left, Jatt, with even more questions after game one. We need to load in and get this series going even further.
Which IG will show up? Which Griffin will show up? Yeah. That's
yes.
What we got this game.
The answer
game.
Is yes.
Yes. Yes, they showed up. And I can't wait to see what this means for the rest of the series, because we know, big picture, it's a world champion. Those are five world championship
yep.
players that just beat Garen Yuumi to win game one. And yep. this is a Griffin who, as you mentioned, have tried gambits at the start of best of fives before, had them fail, and then it didn't really feel like they had a plan B. So what's Griffin's plan B going to be? Because now, with the kog'maw Lulu proving, barely, but proving
yes.
superior,
sure.
IG has that edge.
They had the answer. I don't know if they had the proof. I think the working maybe gets partial credit. The answer, though, was correct. They were able to pick up the victory. What it all means, because very easy to drop the Garen Yuumi and go more conventional, get some more damage out of the mid lane. Or is it, no, it was the execution, roll it back, and potentially lose a game too.
I mean, there were some interesting execution choices right here. We had a very high death game for JackeyLove, tried to maximize that kog'maw passive. That said, 1,183 damage per minute, which I'm not surprised for Hurricane kog'maw with a Lulu against four melee, but